4 years and 8 months back, I walked into Dr. Manita's room as a student. Gave him a present, told him, sir, can I do this for my final year project? He said, that's a good project, but why don't you try doing this? And offered me this new problem. I was terrified by it. It was so difficult. So that was that involved a lot of electronics, and I told him, sir, give me one day, I'll get back to you. The next day I got back to him. My answer was yes. So I took up that project, and it was to do something to do with finding a solution to human element conflict, which later converted something called Japan. Within 1 year, within 1.5 years, we formed a group where Dr. Mante is a principal researcher and Professor Benny Azulman from University of Rochester and Dr. Christina Tapparello from the same university, myself and Yaro from SLIIT. So the work I'm presenting today is not solely my work, it is the work of everybody else here. The objective of this talk, I have several. So let me go in a step-by-step manner and introduce you all to the human elephant conflict in Sri Lanka. Very slightly. And then, why we did what we did. That means we walked down in a particular path and we designed some other circuitry to support developing a kinetic energy harvester for this project. So in order to do that, we had to develop something called a data logger. And I will explain you why we did that. And later, we analyzed the results that we got from that, and we tried to sort of produce an optimized kinetic harvester, which was able to harvest energy from the motion of an elephant. Okay. So that's the path I'm going to take in this presentation. So a brief introduction to head. Head to the sense human elephant conflict. About 100 years back, Sri Lanka has had about 10,000 to 15,000 elephants. But because of this problem, human elephant conflict, there was a really drastic reduction in the number of elephants in Sri Lanka. So why are these elephants important? These elephants are important because the Asian elephant has been enlisted in ICUN, called the International Union for Conservation of Nature, in their red list. So this is an animal which is listed as an animal which is going to go extinct in some time. So our elephant, which is called Elephas maximus maximus, is one species, one subspecies of the animal that is going to extinct. So that's the, our elephant is unique, so we have to protect it. So there is one importance as to why we have to protect this elephant. On the other hand, this human elephant conflict also imposes a lot of problems in Sri Lanka. So these are just simply 3 photos demonstrating how important we have to take care of this issue. First is why villages from damage, so you can see the kind of damage an elephant can do. And then, on the other hand, an elephant killed by a human being. And then, innocent religious crops destroyed by elephants. So, this is the seriousness of this problem that we are dealing with today. Apart from that other problem I explained earlier. So, this kind of motivates us to come up with a solution to this problem. The second is that some statistics for you. On average, there are about 200 elephants and 50 to 60 human beings killed because of this conflict every year. And this map shows the number of kind of areas in Sri Lanka where this problem is happening. You know, carefully, you will see that it is present in the periphery areas along the forests. Okay, so that's where the conflict is really intense, where the near the periphery areas. So people, you know, wildlife conservationists and also wildlife association in Sri Lanka have been trying to come up with several solutions, out of which these two are the most effective thus far. So electric fencing, I'm sure you all have heard about it. It has a very low current and high voltage in this fence. It kind of sort of gives a very small shock to the elephant if it tries to get through the fence. So it tries to stay away. But it doesn't work always the way it does. So sometimes it kills elephants. Right. Second is that the method is called translocation. Now, translocation means you take an elephant which is very dangerous, catch it, and take it to somewhere else and drop it. Some other area that it's just unknown. So what happens is that this process, although it seems very simple, that you just capture a very aggressive elephant, take it somewhere else so that people in that area are safe, you assume. But something we fail to see is the problem the elephant goes through. Okay. We take an elephant from an area that is very comfortable. It knows where water is. It knows where to find its food in that area. So it's very comfortable. It has even friends in that area. And you take the elephant and drop it in a place it has no idea where it is. It doesn't know where water is. It doesn't know where food is. Although this method has been done for quite some time, recent researchers have found out that this method kills a lot of elephants because of starvation, and not just that, of depression. Yes, elephants are capable of being depressed. If they don't have friends, the herd that they used to hang out with, they die of depression. That has been found. So, but we can't help it. So we still use these techniques to kind of reduce the impact of human-elephant conflict. But you can't call these good solutions. But this is what we have so far. So, now I'm deviating a little bit, and I'm going to tell you why people track elephants. Okay. So far there are about three reasons. There can be more. By tracking any animal using geolocation, by monitoring its where it has been throughout its certain period of time, you get to sort of have an understanding about its behavior. How often does it drink water? How often does it, how often does it go with its herd, or where does it really travel? So you get an understanding of its behavior and biological behaviors. So that data is used by researchers for, to do better city planning, right? And then maybe to even, understand and predict certain other things that can happen with animals. And the second thing is, second important aspect of tracking wild animals and rather elephants is wildlife management. So when an elephant gets sick, it will sort of impact its behavior, and it might get stuck to one location and stay for weeks. In that case, if tracking is enabled for that elephant, it will allow us to detect that elephant has been sick, is sick, or so the wildlife agents can actually go and attend to that elephant. So that is another importance of tracking. The third is real-time visualization. So this allows us to have an overview of sort of most of the elephants in a particular area at a particular time. So this will enable us to form a solution, a warning-based solution, so that when a certain elephant goes into a human territory, we are able to generate an alert and sort of warn the people, the related authorities, that there is an elephant coming in there. Okay. So these are three reasons for tracking elephants. So What are the current methods used to track any animal? Some time back, we used to use VHF collars. This method, you have a collar which transmits a very high frequency signal. And one person is required to go after that elephant and track the IT. So when you go closer to that elephant, the beep, the frequency of the beep increases, and you know you're going near that elephant. So just imagine using that to track maybe 2,000 or 1,000 elephants. So that will be very difficult, and you have to do it 24/7 if you want to track. That's sort of not a feasible method to track elephants. So later people came up with this method called collars that have positioning modules. I'm very careful when I use the word GPS, because GPS is one way of positioning. There's another method called GNSS. So in general, we call this positioning methods. So these collars have a positioning module and have something that connects to some method. Maybe a satellite connection, maybe a GSM connection, or maybe in most cases, both. So these collars also incorporate a battery. So using the energy in the battery, they have the ability to transmit their location and hourly or maybe on a daily fashion. So let's say you collar 7 elephants. So you get some amount of locations from those collars, so you know where they are. This method of tracking elephants using collars was exercised by a particular set of group of researchers in Africa using 94 wild elephants. What they did was that they placed collars some elephants in these areas, and they tried to see whether they would issue warnings when these elephants walk into dangerous areas where humans are there. So they succeeded, and they were able to offer warnings within 5 minutes when something, an important event happens. So this method of tracking elephants is a proven method which has been tested in Africa. So you can see that these are the locations of animals. I'm going on to an Amazon EC2 instance. So on this EC2 instance, you have a set of GIS algorithms where it constantly computes whether there is a dangerous scenario. And if there is, it alerts the public. Something on that side. So there are other two uses, as I said, that is for wildlife management. You can use the same data set. And then also for other research purposes to understand and predict animal behavior. Now we come to a problem that is imposed on these collars. How long can these collars last? That is the problem we have. These collars can't last for decades because they are powered by a limited amount of energy in the battery. When the battery depletes, the collar depletes. It's useless. Something I have to stress here is a tremendous amount of effort you need to get the collar around an elephant's neck. Let me explain. So in order to just collar one elephant, you got to go after that elephant for about 2 weeks. An expert team, not just one person. There will be authorities, and there can be wildlife conservationists, and people who are really good at that. So when they find the perfect home they have, which they wait for, they fire an anesthetic at the elephant. So the elephant drops down, kind of unconscious. So they have a short amount of time to do their thing, fix the collar. And once they finish that job, they have to inject something else called antidote, which reverses the effect of the anesthetic. and the elephant comes back to consciousness again. So this process is a tedious process. It has to be done carefully. And you can't afford to do this every 2-3 years just to recharge the batteries. So we want a solution that we fix once on an elephant and works for a long time. That's the kind of idea that we have, that we believe. So that's the kind of purpose of Jambalit. To do that, we exercise the energy harvesting and energy harvesting approach. So where we sort of try to harvest the energy from that's there through when the elephant is walking, convert that to electrical energy and store it into the battery. So that the energy of the battery, it keeps on recharging when the elephant keeps walking. Okay. This is an overview of Jambalit. So these elephants can have energy harvesting collars in them. And they transmit locations from peer to peer. And also through exit relays to a central server. Should the elephant have GSM or coverage, it can directly transmit to the tower. So this is sort of protocol layer, the wireless protocol layer that is being worked at, and that is done by the Ministry of Rochester at this moment. What people here at SLIIT are doing is we are trying to sort of optimize the kinetic harvester to suit the motion of the elephant so that it harvests and gathers sufficient energy to run this protocol. We decided on, we came up with certain harvesting methods which can be feasible on an elephant. One is solar, second is thermal, and third is light. Solar so far has been one of the best methods to harvest energy. It's one of the most efficient methods. But when it comes to harvest energy on top of an elephant, solar has some issues. It can be impacted because elephants bathe dust and mud every day. So we have a bit of a problem with that. Because the solar panel can get covered with mud and dust, and we are not guaranteed to have a perfect exposed solar panel to sunlight every day. The second thing is that the elephant is a very strong animal. It can break the solar panel. And it's a very smart animal as well. That was one reason for us to move away from solar. Of course, we could have solar as well in addition to kinetic harvesting if we want. Thermal so far has not been so efficient. Thermal energy conversion to electrical energy has not been efficient. So there is a difficulty kind of harvesting the amount of energy required to transmit locations using just thermal energy. Finally, we have the most important, which is kinetic energy. That is using electromagnetics to convert kinetic energy into electrical energy and then store it onto a battery so that we can use it later. So this was the viable option that we thought. So what are the requirements for us to design the best kinetic harvester? The very first thing that we have to do is that we have to understand the motion of the elephant, because it's only then we can design an optimized harvester that will work for that motion. So in order to understand the motion of this elephant, we have to design a motion logger. That was the very first thing we did. So we designed a collar which was completely different from that precision logging collar you saw earlier. It was able to log the motion of the elephant, that is to study its motion in 6 dimensions. So we logged about several million records of motion so that we could later analyze it in the laboratory. this was the locker that we created. You have to understand that this is not the collar that we use to transmit locations. This is the collar that we use to lock the elephant's motion. So it's got a 9-degree motion locker, but we lock on the 6 axes, that is the linear acceleration and the gyroscopic acceleration, that is in 6 axes. This is a small computer, microcontroller, which helps us lock this data onto an SD card that's over here. It also has USB connectivity and a JSS module for added use. So, this is a photo of that. So, the elephant involved in many different activities throughout the day. So, it bathed with the collar, it ate with the collar, and it did everything with the collar for 10 days. That's how we collected the dataset, and we monitored the elephant for all of its activities. We recorded the time it ate, we recorded the time it bathed, we recorded the time it was walking, and we recorded the time it was idling. So that later we could relate to this dataset and try to understand what that motion really means. I must thank here several people. This is Tarak Milankar. So these two people were very nice enough to give us offer their elephant to fix our logo. And I must also thank Ms. Nimalika Panel for finding these connections to us and helping us really log this collar on this elephant. All the This is how the logger looked while it was open. So these are the batteries powering up the logging circuitry. Right. So everything, this goes inside this box and it starts a log. Let me show you a small video of the elephant. I with the collar, I think if you would make it more clear. Now that we got the raw data, we want to analyze the data. We found out from any motion data set, there is a method we can do something called a Fourier transform. And we can get the frequency response of the data set. So, something to note is that the slower the motion, the higher the number, peak for lower frequencies. The faster the motion, you'll have much peaks on the higher spectrum. Since elephant's head moves very slowly, we have a lot of peaks towards the lower end. something that's at 0.5 bar and 1.5. So you see some peaks here. So if the key here, what we gathered from the data set is that if we are able to tune our harvester to these frequencies, this means that we can have the most optimum harvester for an elk. This is the key. So let's say you want to design a harvester for a cat. What you would do is that you would log the motion of the cat first and find out which frequencies are most apparent in that data set, which can give you the best energy. And you have to tune your harvester, electromagnetic harvester, to have natural frequency, and that will give you the most amount of energy. And this here shows that this is the acceleration that is present on the elephant in this minus 2. So it shows that there is a large quantity of lower accelerations present and a lower quantity of high accelerations. This is another representation of our data set. This is the linear acceleration of the elephant in three axes, x, y, and z, when the elephant is walking, idling, and sleeping. So when it is walking, you can see that in all three axes, we have some motion. There is some motion in all three axes. But when it goes to idling, look here, we have a motion only in the z axis. That is the head motion I asked you to notice here. And not much on the x and y. And when it's sleeping, there is no energy at all. Based on these parameters, we designed the harvester, which had three magnets. One magnet is here, this is the magnet that moves, and two stationary magnets. So the magnets here and here, they don't move. But the middle magnet moves when there is motion. So the secret here is to optimize the movement of this magnet to match the perfect frequency that I showed earlier. And as this magnet moves across into and fro motion, you would generate some energy in this coil, and we can harvest that into a battery. And we later came up with a simulation model to model this kinetic harvester in a simulation environment, so that we don't necessarily have to change the magnet every time we want to check what happens when the strength of the magnet changes. Instead, we would change its strength on the simulation and then check what really happens. So we don't have to, it's much easier to work in a simulation environment and get the results than actually change. That's what we did. In doing so, we kind of lumped the magnetic properties using a particular variable called alpha, which gave us a little bit of errors. But it's fair enough, but not exact. So this is the experimental line, the line in blue. And you can see that the simulation results vary with the value of alpha. So you got to find the perfect alpha to get the closest fit for the experimental results, which was pretty difficult to do. So our next one incorporated the dynamic behavior that comes from the magnet. So these two graphs were produced using a magnet simulation software called Flux Studio. And we were able to model the flux linkage through the coil and also the flux density, and apply that to a model which was more sophisticated, and it reached very accurate results. Line in red is the simulation output, and the line in blue is the experimental output. And these glitches, small glitches, correspond to small glitches in our test bed, or mechanical glitches. So if we make these perfect, the accuracy of the results would improve significantly. These were the test beds that we used to test our kinetic harvesting. This robot is at this workers are in this is using a robotic arm to play a set of particular set of motion on the harvester, so that we can check what kind of an output is given with the change of as the robot changes the harvester. And this was some other test bed that we made that also allows us to shape the harvester and then observe the kind of energy that is coming from it. This is the kind of problem we have. So we yet haven't tuned our system to this frequency. This is the best place to tune it. So our current research is focused on pushing this thing. So if you push it here, you get the most optimal design. And then we used our results and our simulink model along with the data set to actually see how much energy we can generate for all the actions an elephant does during the day. So as you can see, when the elephant is sleeping, not much energy is generated. And when it's eating, the energy graph rises. That means there is a significant amount of energy from eating. When it's sleeping, no energy. Breathing, no energy. When it walks, a significant amount of energy. And the most important thing to know is when it's idle, there is still energy, because of the head motion up and down. So this graph is for the Z axis, and on the bottom you see for the other two axes. So you don't get much energy from the other two axes. So that is something important to do. There's a lot of energy on the Z axis. There is an up and down motion of the effort that we can harvest. So we played. We had full 7 days of data without any disruption, or the 10 days, because 3 days were sort of spent to update, to recharge the batteries and things of that nature. So we had 7 full days, 24-hour data sets for all 3 accesses. What we did was then we used this model to compute the amount of energy we would get from each axis for each day. It seems that we can hit an average of 88.91 joules per day from the elephant's motion. Now this is how much we're harvesting from the daily activities of the elephant using the harvester. Okay. And then we came up with an energy budget. This is the energy that's required transmit a location to a server somewhere far away. Seems that the total amount of energy that we require to transmit the location is about 22 joules. So we harvest 88 joules on average. We need 22 joules. We have a case. Something to note here is that although we harvest 8 joules in average, there can be losses due to inefficiencies. That means when you convert that whole energy on and store it onto a battery. So we are safe here because it's just 20 gram joules, and with some loss, we can still manage bronze consumption 100%. So this is the kind of work that we have done so far. And further improvements are being made for us to kind of bring out the most optimum frequency of the harvester inside. So that's the kind of work we're doing right now. So I hope you learned something from this presentation, and I thank you very much.
Yeah. higher readings or something like that. But we cannot do that.
Yes. So we have been thinking about it. We wanted to. I know if we can place the harvest device on the lake, it will really lock probably higher amount of energy because there is higher motion there. But we have difficulties having a sustainable collar. The collar can be damaged. Yeah. Because top of the neck is a place that they definitely cannot reach much compared to where it can reach. So that's the reason for us to place the device here. But we have other plans to use the sides of the ring, the collar as well later, to have more harvesting.
First of all, yeah, as I mentioned, that thank you very much for the presentation. And I have a couple of questions. First one is how do you design that routing protocol or the like communication protocol among the elephants as well as the cellular?
Yes, so right now it is still under process, which is done by a different set of groups. So I may not be the best person to answer that question. As I heard, it is done based on epidemic routing.
Okay.
Yes. It means where an elephant would transfer information to another and then it would go on a routing based on.
You're saying that, like, I used to work something like that sort of a routing protocol based on the energy efficient routing protocol. I sent all the documents to Amalinda as well. Please check on that one, like then you can come up with that sort of a, like, you know, energy efficient routing protocol. And recently I found something called NB-IoT, which use like a low power wide area network. So that's one suggestion from me to like enhance that routing protocol. So it says according to those, how to say, their technology document, it says normal battery lasts for 10 years and 50k connections per cell. So I think it is one thing that I wanted to emphasize. The other one that I really wanted to emphasize is that when you're designing that X, Y, Z axis, how you designed that one? Like, what's the Z axis, what's the X axis, and what's the Y axis?
Yes, I
like
that. So to answer the second question, thank you for the suggestion. There are some protocols that are in the market today. NB-IoT, LoRa.
Yeah.
LoRa also comes with a protocol called LoRaWAN. When we designed this, LoRa wasn't as what it is today.
Yeah, it is quite new technology.
It's really
2014.
New,
yeah.
It's been adopted by the community right now. So we haven't still considered whether it's going to move to LoRa because. LoRa has a fixed MAC, and MAC is provided. And I believe the physical layer is proprietary, and the MAC is open source. I'm not really sure about it.
Application layer is proprietary, and the MAC is?
I think the transmission protocol, the physical layer is proprietary.
Yeah, proprietary.
So maybe right now we're using the transmitter called CC1130, which transmits in the sub-1 gigahertz. It's sort of using the same frequency range of the NB-IoT and LoRa, but the way it's sending data, the physical layer is different. So yes, using LoRa and having their own gateways can have improvements. So that is not the area that we have been working in this. So it's a whole new different area. The third question is about the frequency, and you want to know how the XYZ is. Let me show you.
When you are generating that magnetic energy, thing. Like, don't you need to consider all those three axes? Like, in that case, like, you have to fix three of them?
Yes.
Is it
so? Yes, so this is the thing. Now, if we have the harvester, we have this harvesting, this harvester, which is horizontal to us, like this, in this manner, then it is directly under the influence of the Z axis. If we have it like this, then somehow.
Y axis, right?
Yes. So, then if we have it on this, it's this axis. So, it's sort of, you can't use all three axes. So you have to choose one axis. Yeah. Let me show you why we did it.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't, although you see a lot of movement here, this is from minus 2 to plus 2 acceleration. And this is also from minus 2 to plus 2. But if you look at this axis, it goes from 0 to 1.6 minus 2.
But the frequency is so low, right? Like
this is the z-axis has the most amount of acceleration. Let me show you.
Acceleration, yes. But the number of acceleration points are?
Yes, so it also, so the number, it has acceleration, then it goes so 4 to 4. There is some in here as well, but because of the scale, you cannot see the accelerations here. But there is some here as well. So we have really good accelerations in this, and also here in red. So that is the reason for us to go to this axis.
So,
Z is the most important, and I'll show you some other result which is using this. So when we plot the energy curve for all three axes, it's very beneficial if the harvester is aligned with the z-axis. So there's a lot of benefit. But if you are using some other axis, x or y, then the amount of energy you can harvest is very low. So that's the reason for us to just align with Z. So even if we are going to add another harvester, perhaps it's best if we could use the Z axis. Because maybe we can have two harvesters vertically beside the elephant's neck. And it will be harvesting energy like that. So there's two, both are harvesting from the Z axis. Because Z is the most beneficial. Did I answer your question?
Yeah. Is it okay that I ask one question?
Yeah.
Like, when I have that like graph over there,
yes,
from like 12:30 to 2 sleeping, it gave us about like 40 joules. But 22 to 23, it gave us, when sleeping, it gave us about like 100 something joules. Why is that?
Sleeping is there.
Sleeping here and sleeping there gives you, yeah, sleeping there,
so
gives you different amount of joules. Why is that?
Well, so now here it's about approximately 0 joules, right? The rise is this way.
Ah, okay, yeah.
It's accumulating.
Yeah, it is accumulating, right?
So here it's
about like 22.
Yes, so.
Then there it's about like 100.
Well, we already have collected some amount of energy by the time we finished idling. So there is no improvement for the whole of the time of the skipping. So it just stays consistent. It's not good.
Okay. Now I understand.
Yes.
Okay.
So let me explain this again. So this is the zero power of the day. And as we go, this is...
That's the total energy you generate, right?
Yes.
Okay.
It's
accumulating. Yes. So from 0 to 24, these are the number of hours.
Understood.
Yes.
Thanks.
I was wondering if you are planning to keep the motion sensing that deliver this along with the harvest.
Yes.
Okay, so in that case, I feel that the data set coming out of a motion sensor can be used for wildlife preservation kind of aspects as well. You know, it's maybe out of your scope.
Yes.
But still, you know that elephant is moving its usual routing speed.
Yes.
But if there's a change, you may feel that okay, it's not doing well, it's pretty slow, it's short red or something like that.
That's a very good question. I will show you that it's already done by the African group.
Okay.
So you can see that the proximity data is what we call this, what we call such data proximity data. Actually, it's taken by the database. It is collected in the tracker. But in our case, we did not think to include the motion data. Of course, it's true. We can transmit the other data along with the GPS locations. So it's completely doable. But we sort of thought of tracking whether the elephant is moving or not solely using the GPS locations.
So I have a couple of questions regarding the name actually. Now you used to domesticate the elephants together, right? So is there any chance that the male wild elephants would have a different lifestyle and a different
Yes. That's a good question. So what we did here is the analysis of walking. So let's take the walking of a human being in some other district and in Colombia. The walking would be similar in some to a great extent. Bathing, sleeping, eating would be similar. So our data set assumes that there is great similarity between walking of a wild elephant and the walking of a domestic elephant. But the difference comes with the distance it walks. This our energy budget is bound to improve on a wild elephant, because it walks very longer distance throughout the day than a domesticated elephant. So this elephant sort of had a fixed plan. So that would be one reason for us to get this kind of energy. But if we can fix this on a wild elephant, it can generate more energy. But we assume that the walking style and the walking style of a domestic elephant is really similar.
So. And also regarding this style, here they track the location of the elephant like an hour. So would it be possible to do that with Kinetic Harvesting alone?
Yes. So our energy budget here is actually considers that. This is the power transmission.
Same frequency, same number of
transmissions. So what we define as RTM, real-time monitoring, is one transmission every hour.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, that is thank you, speaker, again, and it's wishing luck for his studies as well as any future endeavors. And thank you all for coming, and so we'll continue this. So I hope this was a successful event, and we'll continue this seminar series.